Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents The Bad Mother's Detox by Suzy K. Quinn, narrated by Imogen Church. Before we begin, here is a message from your author, Suzy. Hello there! I'm so happy you've chosen this audiobook. Thank you so much. We're going to have some laughs together in the next few hours. Speak to you at the end, lovely listener. Sunday, 1st of January. Mum's been arrested again. It was the usual charge, disrupting the peace. She was drinking tea with the policeman, playing cards and sharing out her sausage rolls when I picked her up. The police were cheerful too, letting Daisy crawl into the empty cells and jangle their handcuffs. Mum asked me about the Dalton Ball on New Year's Eve. Under different circumstances, I would have shared my evening of drama. Daisy's feckless, irresponsible father begging for my forgiveness. Me telling him to get lost and go home to his heavily pregnant girlfriend. And then ending up in a hotel room with Alex Dalton and having possibly the best night slash early morning of my life. NB, Daisy's birth does not count as the best night of my life. How can it when I shat on the bed? But the police station wasn't the place to relive a romantic encounter, so instead I lectured Mum about proper grandmother behaviour while she signed her release papers. I could tell she wasn't really listening because when I'd finished the lecture, Mum said, "Can we stop at the co-op on the way home? I fancy some Finder's crispy pancakes." Monday, 2nd of January. Alex Dalton called.
"How are you?"
he asked.
"Did you catch up on sleep after New Year's Eve?"
I pictured Alex in one of his marble-floored hotel lobbies, black suit and white shirt, jet black hair, gleaming jawline, like an aftershave model, but a heterosexual one. Stern, uncompromising Alex Dalton. A man who owns hotels in London and has a street named after his family. Asking if I'd caught up on sleep. "I'm okay," I said. "Just a bit of family drama."
"Is Daisy all right?"
"Fine."
Silence.
Then Alex said,
"I want to see you, but I'm flying out to Tokyo for work. I'll keep the trip as short as possible. I hate leaving, but a lot of people are relying on me."
"How can you be working already?" I asked.
"There's no such thing as a holiday in the hotel trade," said Alex. "We have big plans for the Dalton Group this year. Do you have any New Year's resolutions?"
"Just one," I said. "I want to stop Daisy eating biros."
"Come on now, Juliet," said Alex. "There must be something you want."
"Yes, many things. Unstained clothing, leaving the house before 9 a.m, 8 hours uninterrupted sleep, financial support from Daisy's father, and a lovely cottage with roses around the door. But I'd count myself very lucky just to have unstained clothing." Tuesday, 3rd of January. New Year. A time to take stock. Last January, I was living with Nick in London. We were engaged. Things weren't perfect. Nick's mum was always letting herself into the apartment, criticising my parenting and eating fishy salads at the breakfast bar. Nick was drunk half the time and panicky when left alone with Daisy. Also, getting Daisy's pram into the tiny executive lift was a nightmare. But I honestly thought Daisy would grow up with two parents living together. I was wrong. Now I'm staying at my parents' pub in Great Oakley with Daisy in a travel cot while Nick plays happy families with my former best friend who will give birth to their child any day now. Last year, Nick and Sadie's affair felt awful. I wallowed. But then I got on with it. I even ran a marathon. Now, I'm stronger. I've learned that life doesn't end because your ex-boyfriend and ex-best friend are shitheads. And now, Alex and I, well, Things are looking up.
Can't stop thinking about the Dalton ball.
What a night.
Nick was so shocked when Alex and I headed upstairs together.
Chelsea, babe, please, you can't leave with him. Come on, we have a baby together.
Hilarious that, after getting my best friend pregnant, Nick thinks he can have a say in my love life.
Nick still hasn't paid any maintenance for Daisy.
And it's been 6 months since we split up.
Bloody Nick! I suppose I shouldn't be surprised. Everyone warned me not to settle down with a charming bit part actor, but pre-Daisy, I was young and stupid.
In my early 20s, Nick's puppy dog eyes and charismatic personality felt romantic. Then Daisy came along and I realised charm means nothing. Responsibility is everything. Nick's new baby is due any day, so it's not a great time to talk finances, but that's not Daisy's fault.
Sent Nick a text message. Hope you are well. We need to sort out maintenance. If you keep sidestepping this, I'll have to take you to court. Sorry. The text message wasn't strictly true. I don't hope he's well, and I won't be sorry to take him to court, but social nicety is hardwired into me.
Nick hasn't replied yet. Knowing him, he probably won't answer. Denial is his favourite way of dealing with problems.
Wednesday, 4th of January.
Visited Nana Joan this afternoon with the shopping she wanted. Bacon, pork chops, frying steak and beef kidneys. Her care home has a strict vegetarian policy these days, so Nana makes a little on the side selling contraband meat. Nana took one look at my tired face and fired up her portable grill to make bacon sandwiches. She's not supposed to have Calagas in her room, but the staff let her get away with it because it saves arguments at mealtimes. Daisy got really excited about my bacon sandwich and kept making grabs for it. Foolishly, I let her have a bite and she crammed half the sandwich in her mouth before I could stop her, then clamped her little lips closed and stubbornly refused to let me pry them open. Was concerned about salt content, choking, etc. But Nana told me not to worry. Our family are born with unusually large gullets, she said. Your mother used to scoff whole Eccles cakes and no harm ever came to her. Cleaned Nana's portable grill in the ensuite shower room using fairy liquid from the shower rack. Then I helped Nana with her mobile phone. It doesn't ring anymore, she complained. There's something squiffy with it. It turned out to be an easy problem to solve. Nana had confused her phone with the temperature controller. The diagnosis was a relief for Nana because she'd been sweating at night for months. Told Nana, I'm a bit worried about Daisy, rewalking. The NHS website says babies start walking around the age of one, but Daisy hasn't even taken her first step yet. Daisy is 15 months old, I said. Surely she should be able to walk by now. Althea's little boy, Wolfgang, walked at 8 months. Although it proved to be a nuisance, Althea was forever arguing about the price at soft play and eventually resorted to bringing Wolfgang's passport everywhere. But Daisy is walking right now, Nana insisted. Look at her go.
She's not walking, I said, as we watched Daisy pull herself up on the rise and recline chair. She's cruising.
Cruising? Said Nana. Isn't that something you do on a ship?
It's when children hold on to furniture, I said. But it's not the same as walking. I wish she'd take a few steps.
She's probably just lazy, Nana reassured me. Your mum was the same. She only bothered walking if there was cake to be had. The rest of the time, she'd sit and whack your Uncle Danny with her rattle.
Nana asked if I'd seen Nick recently. I saw him on New Year's Eve, I told her. He asked for a second chance.
Steer well clear, said Nana. He's a good-looking waster, that one. Has he paid you any money for Daisy yet?
No, I said. Not a penny.
Better sort that out, said Nana Joan. He'll have another baby soon, won't he?
It's not that simple, I said. As far as Nick's concerned, Daisy and I are staying with Mum and Dad, so he doesn't need to take care of us.
Don't the government just take money from absent fathers these days? Nana asked.
Not in our case, I said. Most of Nick's earnings are undeclared, and he gets pocket money from his mother. There's no tax bracket for that. If he doesn't pay up, we'll have to go to court. Nana asked about the New Year's Eve ball.
I hope you wore something that showed off your figure, she said. I used to have a natural cleavage like yours. These days I need yards of sticky tape.
Nana is what you call a glamorous granny. Even in her 80s, she wears leopard print, lurex and wonder bras. Told Nana that Alex Dalton and I got close at the New Year's Eve ball. I don't really know how else to describe things with Alex. I mean, I suppose we were already close. Alex trained me for the winter marathon last year, and we had a few romantic moments while that was going on. But now, it feels like we're sort of possibly seeing each other.
About time, said Nana. Look at you, all your own curly hair and a lovely bosom. It's no wonder you've been snapped up.
Our lives are different, though, I admitted. Alex is a Dalton. His family own half of London.
Opposites attract, said Nana. Your granddad liked wholemeal bread, whereas I stick to white sliced.
But the truth is, I have baggage with a capital B. Actually, a capital N. Nick. Thursday, 5th of January. Nick phoned at midday, sounding terrified. Sadie is in labour. Nick and I aren't exactly on friendly terms, but I sensed he was desperate for support, so I let him rattle on.
How long does it last?
Nick asked.
Sadie's going mental and we're only an hour in.
Don't you remember my labour? I said. It was over 12 hours.
12 hours?
Nick screeched.
Daisy didn't take that long to come out, did she? That's all day.
I couldn't help adding, you know my friend Althea? Her labour took 5 days. To be fair, I think Althea strung her labour out a bit. She had a big hippie love-in with candles and hummus and cushions and shouted down any midwife who talked about speeding things along. Also, a yogi came to bend Althea's womanly figure into baby-friendly positions and weave her thick, curly black hair into love braids. Baby Wolfgang was breathed into the world with the occasional bellow of Om Shanti.
They won't let Sadie into the hospital yet,
Nick sobbed.
I can't handle this shit, Jules. You know how sensitive I am.
Funny to hear you describe yourself as sensitive, I said. Immature and self-absorbed are the words I'd use.
In the background, I heard Sadie screech,
put on my early Golding album, you useless twat!
Felt a bit sorry for Nick then. But not that sorry. When Nick got Sadie pregnant, my world fell apart. But like Althea said,
karma will get him. Wait and see.
She was right. Friday, 6th of January. Nick and Sadie have had their baby. A little boy.
Actually, really little. Only 5 pounds, 10 ounces. Daisy was 8 pounds and the midwife said things like big strapping legs and a great pair of lungs.
Daisy has a half-brother. Such a weird thought. I wonder if the baby looks like Nick with dark flirtatious eyebrows and blue eyes. Or like Sadie with a big moon face and porcelain skin. Nick and Sadie's baby was born last night by C-section. Nick phoned in the early hours of the morning to tell Daisy about her new brother. He was glowing with new fatherhood, telling me about little baby Horatio and his massive balls.
You've called him Horatio, I said.
Like Penelope Dearheart's dog.
Nick went quiet for a moment.
Well, we can't change the name now, he said. Mum's ordered an engraved silver tankard.
Sadie's doing well, apparently. Not that I asked, but has got a bit possessive. Hissing at anyone who comes near little Horry. Nick sounded slurred, so I'm guessing he'd managed to sneak some whiskey into the labour ward. No surprises there. At Daisy's birth, Nick won the prize for worst birthing companion ever, drunkenly screaming, "What the fuck is that?" at all the wrong moments. Even the midwife asked if I'd prefer he waited outside. Saturday, 7th of January. Nick phoned at 3 a.m. asking if I could put his little girl on the phone. I'm not going to wake Daisy, I told him. It's the middle of the night. Why didn't you ring in the daytime?
Come on, Jules, said Nick. The baby wants to say hello. He's Daisy's brother.
Wow. Brother. Did you get my text message about maintenance payments? I asked. Nick didn't answer, which I took to mean yes. Sort it out, I said, or I'll take you to court. Sunday, 8th of January. Alex just called. He's cutting his Tokyo trip short and flying back next weekend specially to see me. And in possibly the weirdest post-coital conversation ever, he asked if I would attend Mass with him and his mother at Westminster Cathedral. Once I'd ascertained Alex wasn't trying to purge me of sin, I asked why he wanted me to meet his mother.
Because you're an important person in my life, said Alex.
Okay, I managed to say. Yes, I'd love to come. Hung up before I started blubbing girl tears. Think I must still be tired from New Year's Eve. That's the trouble with having children. You never get a chance to catch up on sleep. But I felt so emotional. Meeting Alex's mother. Nick never introduced me to his mother. I met Helen by accident when she let herself into our apartment to give Nick a pair of Gucci loafers she'd picked up at Selfridge's. Helen screamed in shock when she saw me, having had no idea I'd moved in with her son. Not totally happy about Westminster Cathedral as a venue. I might spontaneously combust at the door. Need to sit down with Dad for a quick Christianity recap. He has rubbings from all the famous cathedrals and can recite great chunks of the King James Bible by heart. I haven't been to a proper church service since mine and Nick's wedding day fiasco. And before that, not since school when we all used to snigger at Mrs. Blowers singing in her funny falsetto voice. Monday, 9th of January. Just phoned my old employer, Give a damn, to find out when I can start work again. Left a message, but got the distinct feeling it had fallen into a black hole of messages that will never get listened to. We'll keep trying. Like the idea of using my brain again, but feel guilty about Daisy. Then again, I feel guilty about living with my parents, and I need a job to solve that problem. I suppose guilt and motherhood go hand in hand. Tuesday, 10th of January. My adopted cousin John Boy turned up on the doorstep this morning wearing a huge military rucksack. He left the army last year after losing half his leg in Afghanistan and said he'd come to learn the pub trade. John Boy has gelled black hair, a pencil moustache and lots of tattoos, plus Harley Davidson stickers over the fiberglass part of his prosthetic leg and a Nike trainer on his metal foot. Technically, he's a war hero, although he didn't lose his leg in combat. It got blown off when he jumped from the tank for a roadside wee. Still, we're all extremely proud of him. After losing his leg, John Boy spent a long time in hospital, having fistfights with anyone who used bad language in front of the nurses. Mum ushered John Boy into the living room where he pulled out presents from his rucksack. A jumbo tin of Quality Street for the ladies, Mum, Brandy and me. Army ration lamb stew sachets for Dad's countryside hikes. 20 Afghani pirated DVDs for Daisy and Callum, most of which contained moderate to frequent bad language and violence. After distributing gifts, John Boy started doing push-ups on the floor, clapping his hands between each one. For more of a challenge, he made Callum sit on his back. After eating all the green triangles, Mum asked, "Are you glad to be out of Afghanistan, John Boy?"
"Not really," he said, switching to one-handed push-ups. "I miss the lads, the punch-ups, the 10-mile desert run, staying awake all night on watch. But it wasn't meant to be. The physio said sand and prosthetic legs don't mix."
Then he looked sad and said,
"They won't have me back now anyway, not with half my leg missing."
"You've been living with Trina, haven't you?" said Mum. "What happened? Did she kick you out again?"
"We had a bit of a Barney,"
John Boy admitted, grabbing Callum in a headlock and ruffling his hair.
"You know what Mum's like."
We all exchanged, "Yes, we do," looks. Auntie Trina works in a hospital laundry and is obsessed with germs. She has cleaning products to clean cleaning products. Also, she's deeply religious and carries 3 different Bibles in her handbag. These days, Auntie Trina wouldn't be allowed to adopt, but she and Uncle Danny got John Boy in the 1980s, before psychological evaluations came into it. All they had to be were homeowners and non-smokers. Racial background wasn't considered either. The fact Auntie Trina is black and John Boy is white caused no end of comment and ridicule in the small town where they live. "What did you fall out over this time?" Mum asked. John Boy said Auntie Trina had thrown away his special edition luminous orange Adidas trainers.
"I admit I shouldn't have retaliated," he said.
Apparently, John Boy phoned the local curry house and told them Auntie Trina wasn't really an OAP.
"She won't get free pappadums with her mane anymore," said John Boy. "I'm not sure she'll ever forgive me."
Wednesday, 11th of January. Just had a heated phone call with Nick, re-maintenance. "Daisy and I can't live above Mum and Dad's pub forever," I said. "I'll be going back to work this year and it's time you supported your daughter." Nick said he was trying to be a better dad, a better person.
"Why don't we just get back together?"
he said. "Jesus, Nick, you've just had a baby with someone else," I said. "What on earth are you talking about? Think of your son and Sadie. Cut the bloody theatrics and send me some money."
"I can't do that, Julesie," he replied. "It has to be legal and shit. We need to come to a proper adult agreement."
"But only one of us is a proper adult," I said.
"I am an adult now,"
Nick insisted.
"Living with Sadie has changed me. You can't have 2 irresponsible people in the same house, or there would never be any toilet paper."
Agreed to meet in person tomorrow to sort things out. I know exactly how the meeting will go. Nick will try and charm his way out of paying up. I will shout at him, then we'll have to go to court. Thursday, 12th of January. Met Nick in Hyde Park. It was freezing. Luckily, I'd bundled Daisy into a snow romper suit, ski gloves and boots, thermal hat and scarf. She was more padding than baby. For a change, Nick was on time. He swaggered into the park wearing tight black jeans, UGG boots, a leather jacket, Afghani scarf and sunglasses. Baby Horatio was with him, wearing tinted sunglasses and tucked under a mulberry blanket. He was held aloft in one of those futuristic pod prams like an offering to the gods. "You've dyed your trendy beard," I said. Nick stroked his facial hair.
"Oh, yeah. Someone said it looked ginger, so I used Just for Men."
"Where's Sadie?" I asked.
Doing Instagram shots back at the apartment,
said Nick.
You know, trying to get into mummy modelling.
Doesn't she need her ratio for that? I asked.
He throws up too much to get a good picture,
said Nick.
We've nicknamed him Regurgitron.
How can Sadie do mummy modelling without a baby? I asked.
She photoshops him in afterwards.
Nick looked so tired, drained, like life had beaten him. He certainly wasn't glowing with new fatherhood, and the excitement of Horatio's massive balls had obviously worn off. I suppose anyone would be tired living with Sadie.
How's your mother? I asked. Slaving away over a hot witch's cauldron?
Nick said he didn't know.
Apparently, Helen isn't talking to him right now.
She keeps going on about a credit card bill, but I don't know what she's on about. I hardly ever go shopping in Sloane Square.
Had a quiet smirk to myself, remembering my Sloane Square shopping spree last year, courtesy of Nick's family credit card. Serves Helen right.
Anyway, as Althea said, Nick did offer to buy me clothes if I ran the marathon, so it was only fair.
Nick watched Daisy with tears in his eyes.
She's walking,
he whispered.
And I missed it. Daddy wasn't there.
She's not walking, I corrected. She's just hanging onto the pram. It's called cruising.
Isn't that what gay men do outside nightclubs?
Said Nick. Daisy took one look at Nick's brown, beardy face and started crying.
I love you, Daisy Boo,
Nick simpered.
It's Daddy.
Nick, you're a stranger to her, I said. You hardly ever visit. How would you feel if a beardy stranger picked you up?
That's very hurtful, said Nick. There's no need to knock the beard.
Then Horatio started crying and threw up cottage cheese sick over his mulberry blanket. Nick went white.
Christ,
he said.
Sadie's going to kill me.
He ran off in search for dry cleaners. I told him I'd text over my bank details.
Friday, 13th of January. Woke up this morning to find little Callum hiding under my bed wearing a gremlin mask. I nearly screamed the house down. I have a love-hate relationship with my mischievous nephew. Callum is a great kid, but he can also be challenging. In other words, a little shit. Some people say he lacks a father's firm hand, but my little sister Brandy is pretty strict, screeching at him morning, noon and night. Anyway, Callum said he was playing a Friday the 13th trick.
You're getting confused with April Fool's Day, I told him when my hysterics had worn off. Friday the 13th is just unlucky.
Callum thought about that.
Won't bet on the footy today then, he said. You're betting on football matches? I asked. How? You're 5 years old.
Apparently, Callum's primary school has its own highly sophisticated bookmaking system, using match attacks cards and keepy uppies as gambling currency.
Saturday, 14th of January. Told Dad I'm meeting Alex and his mother at Westminster Cathedral tomorrow. Dad's eyes filled with happy tears and he said,
I always dreamed you'd discover the true meaning of love.
Mum said, I'll say this for religion, it wears you down the nearer you get to dying. But if it's mass, at least you'll get free biscuits.
Daisy perked up at this.
Biscuit, biscuit!
Dad looked stern.
It's not only about biscuits, Daisy, it's about Jesus. Anyway, you get wafers at Mass.
Jesus biscuit?
Daisy asked.
Mum said, they probably sell Jesus biscuits at Aldi, Daisy. You get all sorts of weird confectionery there.
Sunday, 15th of January. Mass at Westminster Cathedral. managed to get Daisy into a nice dress, but she ruined the look by accessorising with one orange and one striped sock, both pulled up to knee height over the leggings, and a black swimming cap. After half an hour of screaming, scratching and biting, Mum said, "Oh, let her wear all that weird stuff, love. She's going to church. Judge not, lest ye be judged." So I took Daisy to our nation's most famous cathedral, dressed like a lunatic. Met Alex outside Westminster Cathedral at 10 a.m. in a swirling crowd of well-dressed Londoners and wide-eyed tourists. Alex wore his Sunday best, which was basically the same crisp black suit and white shirt he wears all the time, teamed with a wool coat and leather gloves. He pulled me into a long, serious hug and told me he'd missed me. Then he held my face and looked right into my eyes with that intense stare of his. When Alex noticed Daisy, he smiled and knelt down to the McLaren.
"That's a very fetching cap you're wearing," he said, shaking Daisy's hand. "My mother always says that ladies should wear hats to church."
Daisy said,
"Church? Biscuit?"
"Well, I don't have any biscuits," said Alex, "but I did bring you one of these, if it's okay with your mummy."
He pulled a packet of fruit yo-yos from his suit pocket and turned to me for approval. "She loves those," I said. "How did you know?"
"I asked,"
said Alex.
"My PA has young children. Come on, let me introduce the pair of you to Anya."
"Anya," I said. "Your mother's called Katrina, isn't she?"
"Anya is what Zach and I call her,"
Alex explained.
"It's the Hungarian word for mother."
He stood then and pushed the McLaren towards the cathedral. Katrina Dalton was by the steps, laughing gaily and shaking hands with tourists like she was a visiting dignitary. She wore a fitted pencil skirt, black high heels, and a ruffled white blouse with a jewelled brooch at the collar. Her white blonde hair was in its usual French pleat under a swooping black hat, and her gleaming skin was stretched tight over sharp cheekbones. Heavy kohl lined her eyes, and her lips were bright pink with gloss. I must admit, Katrina looks great for 50-something, even if she does dress like someone out of Dallas. But then she's had a lot of work done, including a fairly disastrous nose job that's given her Michael Jackson nostrils. Alex waved at her.
"Anya, this is Juliet, the girl I've been telling you about, and her daughter, Daisy. You've probably seen her at our New Year's Eve balls and around the village."
Katrina gave me a celebrity smile and a little gloved wave, then turned on high heels and glided into the cathedral. I felt like a rejected autograph hunter.
"I wouldn't swap her,"
said Alex.
"Most of the time. Come on, let's get you two inside. It's cold."
Alex parked the McLaren, then led us into the magnificent cathedral. I ended up squeezing onto a pew beside Katrina Dalton, hemmed in by Alex on the other side. Katrina gave me another benevolent smile, eyes glazed and unseeing. I smiled back, clutching Daisy. Soon, the singing started. I mumbled along where I could. Alex didn't sing at all, which made me feel better.
"Why aren't you singing?" I whispered. "Don't you know the words either?"
"I don't sing in public,"
Alex said, taking my hand and squeezing it.
"Do you sing in private then?" I asked.
"No."
"But you have a piano at your house."
"I haven't played that in a long time."
After the singing and some prayers, everyone lined up for wafers and ribena from the priest. I blurted out to Alex, "We're not baptised or anything." Alex laughed.
"Nor is Anya. You don't have to go up if you don't want to."
Behind me, I felt Katrina Dalton bristle.
"Alex, what are you saying? Of course I am baptised."
She pushed past us then and joined the sacrament queue. Alex whispered,
"I shouldn't have said that. Anya has a certain image to uphold. It doesn't necessarily link to reality."
Daisy noticed the wafers in the golden communion bowl then and pointed excitedly at the priest, shouting, "Mummy! Biscuits! Biscuits!" Then she tried to clamber over Alex. Alex held Daisy to stop her falling.
"It looks like Daisy wants to take the sacrament. Should we go up?"
"Okay," I said, "but we've never been blessed before."
"You're blessed every day of your life,"
said Alex, handing me Daisy.
"You have this, little one. Look, just bow your head, hold out your hand and say Amen, then take a wafer for Daisy. It's not strictly allowed, but otherwise I think you'll have a riot on your hands."
"Okay." As we approached the huge nostrilled priest, I threw on my best religious smile. "Good morning, Father." The priest looked down at Daisy.
"What colourful clothing."
I bowed my head and held out a hand for the wafer. But while my attention was on the stone floor, Daisy grabbed 5 wafers from the priest's golden bowl and stuffed them into her mouth. Then she reached for his giant cup of Ribena.
"Oh, no, little one," chuckled the priest. "You can't have that."
"Mine?"
Daisy inquired.
"No, my child."
"Mine?"
Daisy decided, clamping both hands around the cup.
"Daisy,"
I said. "Daisy, no."
"Daisy, naughty."
"Mine!"
Daisy shouted so the word rang around the stone walls. The priest pulled. Daisy pulled. Then Daisy, sensing she was losing the battle, sank her teeth into the priest's kindly fingers. In slow motion, the chalice shot up into the air, splashing vivid purple Ribena over the stony floor. The cup rolled noisily down the stone steps, coming to a stop by a frightened-looking old lady. There was a stunned silence. Beside me, I noticed Alex holding back a smile. Then I heard Katrina Dalton's distinctive Hungarian accent.
"Good God!"
Daisy erupted into angry tears, landing a few well-aimed punches on the priest's arm before I could carry her away.
"No, man! Bollocks, man!"
I hurried down the aisle and out of the cathedral, with Daisy howling over my shoulder. On the hard grey steps, I sat Daisy on my lap and dabbed her teary cheeks. Then I heard Alex's leather shoes hitting concrete and felt him sit down beside me.
"Juliet,"
said Alex, eyes twinkling with amusement.
"How was your first Holy Communion?"
"Awful," I said. "I'm so embarrassed."
"Don't be."
Alex took my hand.
"You were wonderful."
"Something tells me your mother doesn't think I'm wonderful."
"My mother doesn't usually pay much attention to other people. But I think you've made your mark."
"By bringing a swearing child into her place of worship?"
"Anya's not as devout as she makes out. She wasn't brought up Catholic. She converted when she met my father. Come on, let me take you for lunch."
After sandwiches and soup at a nearby deli, Alex bought us takeaway coffees and we pushed Daisy along the Thames. Late afternoon, as darkness fell, Alex called a driver to take us home. He spent ages checking Daisy's car seat and even made sure I was strapped in properly too. "It's okay," I said. "I know how to work a seatbelt." Alex looked serious.
"I like to make sure. I'd hate it if anything happened to you."
We held hands the whole way home. When we reached Mum and Dad's pub, Alex kissed me goodbye.
"We'll try again with my mother another time, okay?"
he said. "Okay," I said. "Thanks for today." We smiled at each other. Then Alex kissed me again and said,
"See you soon."
Monday, 16th of January. Just checked my bank account. Predictably, there was no money from Nick. I've arranged a last chance meeting with him. Alex has been texting from New York. I get all giddy and excited when a new message arrives.
Alex always asks questions. Where are you? What are you doing? Are you okay? So different from Nick's former romantic messages, which were usually pictures of himself in various amusing poses. Alex isn't happy that I'm meeting Nick tomorrow. He referred to Nick as Nick Spencer and wrote he was disappointed with my choice of companion. But what can I do? I don't have a choice of companion. I'm stuck with Nick for Daisy's sake. Can Alex and I really work past one amazing night? I mean, really. I suppose anything's possible. We'll have to reread Cinderella. Tuesday, 17th of January. Met up with Nick again, this time at Taylor St. Barista's near our old flat in Canary Wharf. Correction, my old flat. Now, Nick and Sadie's current flat. Nick started with usual theatrics, sobbing that Daisy barely recognised him. If you want Daisy to recognise you, make a proper visitation schedule, I said. No more of this as and when business. Think of your daughter for a change.
And how do I do that?
Nick demanded.
Sadie keeps my balls in the bedroom drawer. The only reason she let me out today was because I'm wearing a geo-tracker.
Let's talk about maintenance, I said.
I offered you 50 quid a month.
No, I snapped. You can afford more than 50 quid a month.
My income is complicated,
Nick wheedled. We can always prove your income in court, I said.
Can't we just get back together, Jules? Said Nick, sounding tired. I know I screwed it up, but I can't turn back the clock.
Forget it, I said. Your focus should be on Daisy and your new family.
It is, he insisted. But paying money is so final, isn't it?
Then Nick tried to cuddle Daisy in her big snowsuit. She looked like an alarmed starfish. Look, Nick, I said, taking Daisy before she cried. I'm being more than reasonable. I just want you to start paying up as of now, that's it. No back payments or anything. Nick got all actor-teary then and said,
You're right. I'm no good at being an adult. Fucked up.
Blah, blah, blah. Asked if he still had my bank details and he said,
Yeah, yeah. I'll sort it, okay?
Wednesday, 18th of January. Alex took me to the cinema last night in Leicester Square. He was very gentlemanly, sending a driver to pick me up and helping me out of the car when I reached the busy city. As we walked through the crowds, Alex held me tight and glared at anyone who jostled me.
Did you wear your seatbelt in the car?
Alex asked as we headed into the cinema. Of course I did, I laughed. What is this obsession with seatbelts?
Sorry, said Alex. It's to do with my mother. She never wears one. It used to worry me to death as a child.
And now?
Now I know my mother is a law unto herself. So I just have you to worry about. And Daisy.
As we took our seats, Alex grilled me about meeting Nick. He wanted to know every detail, if Nick had arrived on time, what was said, if Nick had done anything inappropriate. I told Alex that Nick was his usual sidestepping, feckless self. Alex said,
I don't like you seeing him.
We were silent for a bit after that. Then my phone rang. It was Mum. I'd asked her only to call in an emergency, but our ideas about emergencies are different. She rang three times during the film to ask where I'd last seen Daisy's sleep blanket, if I could sing Daisy a bedtime song down the phone, if I wanted to do FaceTime and see Daisy sleeping like an angel. The other cinema goers got a bit fed up with me, especially when I sang a whispery lullaby. There were a few exaggerated huffs and sighs, and someone whispered, "For goodness sakes!" I felt I couldn't go to the toilet after causing so much disruption, even though I really needed to. It got quite uncomfortable by the end because the film was nearly 3 hours long and had lots of underwater scenes. Plus, the man next to me had a particularly large, slurpy drink. Thursday, 19th of January. Fucking bloody bollocking Nick. Oh my God. I was so blind with fury this morning that I put my dress on backwards.
Have just received a signed for letter from Nick's solicitor saying he is applying for residency of Daisy.
This is absolutely outrageous. After being absent for the best part of a year, not paying maintenance and getting my bridesmaid pregnant, Nick now thinks Daisy should live with him. Why? Why? What is he playing at? He must know there is no fucking way on earth he'll get residency. The letter said that prior to any court hearing, Nick and I must attend a mediation information and advice meeting, or MIAM. MIAM looks a lot like MAME, as in to hurt or cause harm. Couldn't those mediators have thought of a better acronym? After mediation, Nick will apply for a child arrangement order. I'm so furious! How dare he?
Friday, 20th of January.
Rang Nick 20 times, but he didn't answer. The cowardly little shit. I marched around to Helen and Henry's house with Daisy in tow. Normally, I'd rather lick rats than visit my ex-mother-in-law, but I needed someone to shout at and decided she'd have to do. Helen was on her way out, pulling red leather driving gloves onto her sinewy hands. Her manic blue eyes looked startled when she saw me, and she tipped her head back to look down her long bird beak nose.
"I was just going into town," she said. "Whatever it is, can't it wait?"
I told her that no, it bloody well couldn't wait, and how dare Nick apply for residency when he's been an absent father and not paid a penny in maintenance. Helen gave a patronising smile and patted the ends of her wiry black bob.
"He wants you back, Juliet, and a chance to father his daughter. How long are you going to humiliate him like this?"
"Humiliate him?" I exclaimed.
"Neither of you is perfect. You're both still learning to be parents."
"Fuck off, Helen," I said. "I'm with my little girl every day, every single day. What does your son do?"
"Nicholas hasn't had a chance to be a father," said Helen. "You've kept his daughter from him."
"What a load of bollocks," I said. "Nick didn't ring me for months after the wedding, and he hasn't paid a penny towards Daisy."
"I'm not going to talk about finances," Helen snapped.
"He's just doing this to dodge the maintenance issue, isn't he?" I shouted. "He lives in London, for Christ's sake. What court would give an absent father residency and move a child from their location?"
Helen raised an eyebrow. "As a matter of fact, Nicholas is moving closer to home. We're investing in a proper family home for him, somewhere near Henry and I." I said a lot of bad words then.
Henry lumbered into the hall in his tweed jacket, buttons straining over his large belly, gingery grey hair in strands over his bald head.
"What's all this?"
I said a cheery hello to Henry, then barked at Helen. "You should be ashamed of yourself and your son."
"I don't have time for this, Juliet," said Helen,
pushing on unnecessary sunglasses and strolling towards her silver Land Rover. "Tell Nick he'll never get residency of Daisy," I shouted after her. "Never!"
Helen turned,
gave me another patronising smile and said, "Perhaps if you want to rethink your behaviour, these maintenance threads, then Nicholas will rethink his position too." Saturday, 21st of January. Finally got through to Nick. Asked him what the hell he was playing at.
"Desperate men do desperate things, Juliet," he said.
"No one's stopping you seeing your little girl," I shouted. "But how on earth can you think this could be in Daisy's best interests? Putting us through a custody battle."
"I want my family back," he said.
"This isn't about what you want," I said. "Think of Daisy, for goodness sake. What's best for her?"
"When Daisy grows up, she'll thank me,"
Nick insisted.
"She'll say, 'Clever Daddy, Mummy was being silly, but you made me live with you, and then Mummy came back. You'll see.'"
"Ugh, you're a spoiled child, Nick," I said. "We're not getting back together."
Sunday, 22nd of January. Alex called. He was in the first class lounge at Heathrow Airport, about to jet off to Dubai, and wanted to tell me how much he was going to miss me.
Aww.
Told him about Nick wanting residency, and he was suitably disgusted.
"The man can't even dress his age," said Alex. "Why is he trying to play the father all of a sudden? He can't look after himself, let alone a child."
"Another child," I said. "Sadie's had her baby."
"Did the hospital check it for horns and claws?"
Alex asked, which I thought was pretty funny.
"Why would Spencer want residency?"
said Alex, in a pondering voice like a murder mystery detective.
"He says he wants his family back," I said.
Alex was silent for a long time. Then he said,
"I suspected as much."
"Nick's a lot of hot air," I said. "You can never trust what comes out of his mouth."
"You shouldn't see that man anymore," said Alex, his voice low. "He's not to be trusted."
"What?" I said. "I have to see him. He's Daisy's father."
Silence. Then Alex said,
"I hate that he's in your life."
More silence. "Alex?"
"I have to go. It's getting busy here."
It did sound a little noisy at his end. Someone was kicking off about the buffet lobster tails being fucking tiny and the caviar trough running dry.
Monday, 23rd of January. Nick asked if he could come to the pub today to see Daisy. Although I'm still furious with Nick, I agreed for Daisy's sake. He is already over an hour late. Just left an angry message saying that if he can't turn up on time, he shouldn't bother. I've got the tea mugs ready for when Nick finally shows up. My tea will be in the striped mug, obviously. Evening. 2 hours late. And Nick brought Helen with him. I had to physically restrain Mum when she saw Helen on the doorstep. She wanted to squirt her with Callum's super soaker. I screeched at Nick about responsibility and timekeeping and how dare he take me to court, then slammed the door in his beaten puppy face. Oh, God, I was so furious. Helen tapped softly on the door.
"Juliet, be reasonable. Nick wants to see his daughter."
"You'd never be late for a business meeting, Helen," I shouted. "What's your excuse about this one?"
"Good news," said Helen brightly. "Your joint bank account has been unfrozen and put into your name, so you have access to funds. Can't you see how reasonable we're being?"
I shouted back, "That's my own bloody money, Helen. Not a penny of it was Nick's. Tell him to pay me maintenance and drop this bloody court case."
Silence.
Then I heard Helen mutter, "She's..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.